Well, hello, church. Welcome. And those who are watching online, glad that you're with us. Glad that you're tuning in. We're excited to worship together today. We've kind of changed the band up, stripped things down a little bit. And I love doing that every once in a while. Because whenever we do this, whenever we strip things down a little bit, there's something about hearing more voices in the room kind of erupt in praise. And I just want to remind us, whether you're online watching or you're here in the room, this is not like you guys sit and observe what's happening here. We are invited to usher in the presence of God. That is awesome news that we get to do this together. And so why don't you stand, why don't you join us as we worship?
Great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could so great a mercy, what heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me in.
Hallelujah.
Beautiful Savior, oh, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living.
Come on, we lift our voices today.
Oh, hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me, 'cause you have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Oh, it has no claim on me today. Yes. Come on. This is truth. This is where our hope lies. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours. Oh, Jesus, yours is the victory. No, hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. on me, 'cause you have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me, 'cause you have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Oh, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Oh, God, you are my living
of your heart a billion years, still I'll be singing. How can I praise you enough? How can I praise you enough?
Come on, we say,
oh, you are the Lord Almighty, I'll shine in all the stars in glory. Oh, your love is like the wildest ocean. Oh, nothing else compares.
Creation calls.
Creation calls all to the Savior. We are alive for your praise in earth and sky. Oh, no one is higher. Our God of wonders, you reign. Our God of wonders, you reign. You are the Lord Almighty, outshining all the stars in glory. Your love is like the wildest ocean. Oh, nothing else compares. You are. You are the Lord Almighty, outshining all the stars in glory. Your love is like the wildest ocean. Oh, nothing else compares. But to your name we lift up all praise. Not to us, but to your name we lift up all praise. Oh, not to us, but to your name, Jesus, we lift up all praise. To your name, Jesus, we lift up all praise. You are the Lord Almighty, outshining all the stars in glory. Your love is like the wildest ocean. Oh, nothing else compares. You are the Lord Almighty, outshining all the stars in glory. Your love is like the wildest ocean. Oh, nothing else compares. We're singing how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, oh, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. Singing how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, oh, how wonderful is my Savior's love for we're singing now, marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
One of the things we've said around our church is that we have some anchor points, some things that while things change, while things come and go, ministry programs, how we do life together, we have a few anchor points to kind of hold us secure in the midst of all the changing times. And one of our anchor points is that we would be a gospel-motivated church, that we would be moved personally first and then motivated to go and serve for because of God's love for all people. So we're not moving, we're not serving because of the pats on the back or what people would say about us or about our church. We want to move and serve in the community because God first loved us, us being people, not us being those in the room. Do you still believe God loves people? All right, I think three people here, hopefully people online believe that God loves people because you're a little quiet in here. We believe that God loves the world. People like us, people different than us, people who share values, people who are contrary to us, people who are for us and people who are against us. And maybe you're here tonight not sure where you stand in all that mix. God is for you and loves you. And so that's why we serve, that's why we move. And part of loving, as I've said before, sometimes the hardest people to love are right here in this room. Sometimes it's hard to love your own family. And I don't know, 5-6 weeks ago, I shared with you that some of our own family was hurting and grieving. And 5 weeks ago, Pastor Mark stepped back from ministry. Many of you have talked to him. He's going through a hard time. And I spoke to him this week, and at his request, he asked if I'd share an update. Mark has asked to be released from Yarmouth Wesleyan. He's asked to resign his ministries here. This is not punitive. This is not moral implications. This is nothing but restorative. Mark got to a place where he needs to focus on his own health, his own heart. As I said to you 5 weeks ago, he needed to receive some ministry, not lead in ministry. Does that resonate? And so I met with Mark this week. We've spoke a few times. And at his request, he said, I need to be released from even the pressure of thinking I'm coming back someday. I need to focus on me and my family for a while. Their intention is to stay in the Yarmouth area. They love the community. They love the church. They love you all. They were at church last Sunday. Some of you got to chat with them. And so he is resigning his formal position at the church effective this weekend, but not resigning his role in our church as a family member. He is a part of our family. We will love and we will serve and we will do the things we sing with people right here in this room and in our community. Amen. So drop Mark an email, hit him up on Facebook, connect with them, serve them as you would anybody else. They are part of our family. One of the things we want to believe to be true about people like Mark, the Brewers, myself, yourself, is that we believe in a God who reconciles, restores, and redeems. We do not believe that dead is dead all the time. Sometimes in God's kingdom, he has other things at play. And so when we sing songs like Graves into Gardens, we truly believe that God can restore and redeem in ways that confounds the world and the world's wisdom. And so Well, when we sing this song, would you not just sing it? Would you pray it? Would you declare it over yourself, over your family, over the Brewer family, over Yarmouth, over Barrington, Clare, Tuskett, Pubnico? Would you start praying and believing you are a God who can redeem and restore? Amen.
I searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. A man's empty praise and treasures of faith are never enough. Then you came along, you put me back together. Eyes now satisfied, hearing your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing, nothing is better than you. I'm not afraid to show you my weakness, my failures and flaws. Lord, you've seen them all, and you still call me friend. 'Cause the God of the mountain, oh, is the God of the valley. I know it's true. There's not a place your mercy and grace won't find me again. No, no, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing, nothing is better than you. Confident in that today, you turn mourning to dancing, you give beauty for ashes, it's our prayer. You turn shame into glory, 'cause you're the only one who cares. Turn our mourning, you turn mourning to dancing, give beauty for ashes, you turn shame into glory, you're the only one who keeps turning on mourning. You turn mourning to dancing, you give beauty for ashes, you turn shame into glory, you're the only. Better than you, oh, there's nothing Nothing is better than you. We believe it for our community that there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing. Nothing is better than you.
Would you join me in prayer? Heavenly Father, there's one layer of that song. When I first heard it, it was catchy. There was rhythm, there was energy, there's emotion behind it. But Lord, every time I sing that song, the message actually gets deeper and deeper and deeper. There's such convicting and declarative language when we, the church, sing, there's no one else who can. You're the only one who can. There's this part of the song where we're not just singing because it's exciting. We're actually declaring our dependence on you. We're going all in and we're surrendering, saying, God, if you don't come through, we're not looking anywhere else. We're not hedging our bets. There's no backup plan. We have gone fully in. We have surrendered and we're banking everything on you being who you said you were. And so, God, we need you to move. God, we need you to restore and to redeem and to reconcile. God, we care about our leaders of this church, but we care about the people of our church. We care about our community. We care about people. And God, there are people in this room today. There are people who are watching online. There are people who are avoiding this place who need you to turn a grave into a garden. And sometimes they're terrified to ask because you just might do it. But God, would you give us the courage to lean into you? Would you restore our hope for what you can do? God, we fix our eyes deeply into you. So God, we ask that you move. We ask that you would stir. God, we ask that you would speak to your people, to your church, as we want to hear a word from you for how we worship you, for how we serve, and how we move into the community, God. So this is your church. Have and do with it what you will. And we ask this and we say this in your name. Amen. You may go ahead and have a seat, or you may go ahead and keep sitting if you're watching online. This church, whether you go to Yarmouth Wesleyan, whether you're watching and maybe Coastal is your home church, or maybe you have made plans to join the South Church team and help that launch process this fall, whether you are at Yarmouth, Coastal, or South Church, here's what I know is true for all of us. We exist to take Jesus into every community of Southwest Nova. Right? There's no backup plan. It's not and to start a Christian softball league. We don't exist to take Jesus in every community and start a quilting club. I love quilts. If you want to make me one and drop it off my house, I'll use it. But that's not why the church exists. We don't exist for a whole bunch of reasons. We exist to take Jesus into every community of Southwest Nova. We have said that numerous times over the years, and sometimes when we say community, we mean geographical place. Tuscan, Pubnico, Yarmouth, Clare. We talk about geographical areas. But sometimes when we talk about communities, we mean people groups. There are all kinds of little hubs and clubs all over Southwest Nova that even in one town or one community, there's groups of people. And there are people in this room that are uniquely positioned in those communities to be the light and hope for people who need it. Meaning, if you don't walk out your Christian responsibility in those spaces, maybe nobody else will. That's not to add pressure as much as it is to add opportunity that God wants to use you where you are. Because when Jesus was talking to his disciples, he said, as you go, make disciples and baptize them. And we look at that phrase, you know, as you go, the idea that Jesus was saying, not that you would pick up and declare, this time I'm going to go and do a missional type thing. The idea was as you go, as you do life, as you head to the boats, as you head to the hospital, as you head to the classroom, as you head to the kids' playroom, as you head to the parks, as you go and do life, share the love of Jesus. Does that resonate? Which means whatever you're doing, it is an opportunity to serve and love somebody that you bump into. So when we talk about communities, yes, it may be geography, but it may be people groups. It may be types of people. There's all kinds of things there. And so whether that was going and partnering in Barrington, whether that was the South Church stuff, whether that's Love Week, whether that was the Mariner Center, there's all these expressions of how we are trying to practice what we believe to be true about our vision statement. And I believe it with all that I am, except when I don't. I'm all in on the vision statement, except when I'm all out. I don't know if you're like me, but I found myself the last 18 months acting in ways that were contrary to the vision that I have cast before you for 5+ years. That vision statement was something that God birthed in my heart that I brought and submitted to the board, brought to the staff, brought to you as a church family. I've preached on it. I have pleaded with you that this is why we will exist, to take Jesus. And then I have found myself the last 18 months doing the opposite. And I don't even mean accidentally. I mean like intentionally, maliciously living against the vision that I preach to you. I have found myself walking on the sidewalk the last 18 months and seeing another human being coming down the sidewalk. And as they come, I do this. And I get away, far away from them as far as I can. Sometimes when I'm feeling super loving, I will cross over to the other side of the street as to avoid them. I find myself going into the mall or to Sobeys and looking around at this looking back at me. And I find myself wondering, do I know everybody in here or do I know nobody in here? I find myself looking at people as they approach me and them thinking, weirdo, stop staring at me. Like, oh, you remind me of some, your eyes remind me of somebody else. And I find myself walking in these public spaces where I don't know if I know people or don't know people. Just put your head down. Do your business, because I don't know if I should be ignoring somebody, if I should be making contact, but I have found myself dehumanizing my interactions in public spaces. I have found myself, even though I'm an extreme extrovert, the last 18 months shrinking my social gatherings, not because I don't want to hang with people, but I don't know if people want to hang with me. I don't know what people are comfortable with. I don't know if they want to be in my home. I don't know if they want me in their home. And so I found myself shrinking the people I connect with. And then, in ways that I have never done or felt before, I found myself cringing when a text or a phone call or a Facebook message would come in. I have never felt this before. In the 5.5 years that I've been your pastor living here in Yarmouth, I have never cringed seeing some of your names pop up on my phone with a message, except for the last 18 months. Because I have found to be true that everybody has a piece of bad news to share. I don't know what it is, but the volume of tragedy seems tenfold higher the last 18 months than the previous 4.5 years. Am I alone on any of this? I have found this to be an incredibly difficult and maddening and frustrating and emptying 18 months. Agreed? I was told day after day after day, be careful of people. Be careful of new people. Don't let people into your home. Don't leave your community. And if you're sitting here thinking, yeah, here we go, time to kick the government and the medical, not at all. I'm not at all implying that somehow I was persecuted the last 18 months. I was inconvenienced at best. We live in maybe the greatest place on God's green earth the last 18 months. Somebody better say amen. Amen. We are blessed to have been in Yarmouth. We could all be doing this in New York City the last 18 months. We are blessed to have been in our location the last 18 months. That still being true, people were villainized. Strangers were villainized. We in the pursuit of safety had to dehumanize each other for a while. And while there was wisdom in it for a season, you cannot live there forever. I would even go one step farther. The church cannot stay in that state forever. We will have to find ways and times and places and spaces where, with all the safety precautions, with all of the honoring the leaders and kings in high positions, you're thinking, well, not so-and-so, because I hate so-and-so. Scripture says all the kings and all the leaders in high places. Well, except for when you, like, rally and fight against them, right? Nope, Scripture says pray for your leaders. Well, and pick it, right? The double P's of the church, pray and pick it. Nope, just pray. We pray for our leaders. That's what the church does. And so in the spirit of serving and being honorable, we will have to find ways where we still go back to the vision that God birthed in our hearts to take Jesus into every community of Southwest Nova. If I have to wear a mask to take Jesus in a new community, then I'm going to mask up. If I have to wear 16 pairs of gloves to take Jesus into a new community, then I'll wear 16 pairs of gloves. What I have found myself processing lately is to stop being distracted by sideways energy. In my scriptures, it said Jesus healed the lepers. And I wonder what a modern day leper would be. Because I cannot live in fear of getting something from somebody when Jesus went ahead and loved the lepers. So I'm gonna be an honorable citizen. I'm gonna do my part to lead by example. But what I want to talk about for our time together is, are we still as passionate about the vision as we were before it got complicated? Because while you and I were thrown sideways by some of these restrictions, some of these rules, God wasn't. It's not like when we went on lockdown, God also went on lockdown. I also want to contend to you, while we went on lockdown, people didn't stop suffering. That may be brand new information for you. Like, while we were on lockdown, all the world's problems got paused, right? Of course not. So what I want to do is kind of have a family chat for our time together. What do we do with this vision of taking Jesus into every community? Because here's what I sense beneath my conversation tonight. You're all exhausted. How do I get up and rally a church or three churches or three campuses around this idea of, like, let's take Jesus in every community? And you're like, I had a hard enough time getting to church today. I'm exhausted. I put all my energy into getting through these last 18 months, and we barely got through. Do you know how frustrating it is to do online learning and so on and so forth? I hear you, and I'm with you, but what do we do with the call to take Jesus into every community of Southwest Nova while acknowledging you're all tired? Do you have enough energy to say amen? You're tired, aren't you? You must be, because you tell me it all the time whenever I talk to you. Everybody is exhausted. You bump into it over and over and over. Some of you are so tired, you're just watching online. There's a passage I went to. There's a piece of scripture I've been lingering in this week, and this text I just keep soaking on, because I wonder if Jesus, if he was invited to preach today, if he would share this passage too. There's something so unique about this passage. I want you to read it with me, and I'm going to pull out a few observations. In Matthew chapter 9, Jesus is about to do a teaching to a crowd of people, but if you look back at 9:14, 9:18, 9:27, 9:32, here's what you see. Jesus restores to life a girl and heals a woman miraculously. He heals two blind men, and he heals a man unable to speak, and then he steps into this teaching. Miracle, healing, over and over again, and then here comes the teaching in 9:35. And Jesus went throughout all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom and healing every disease and every affliction. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them, because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. And then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." Now, last week I preached on Zacchaeus, if you were here, if you watched. Zacchaeus is a short passage we looked at, but it was full of detail. You have people's names. You have job titles. You have status. You have career. You have government. You have him running. You have him climbing a tree. You have the kind of tree. You have home invitations. You have all this detail and vivid picture about Zacchaeus and Jesus meeting, and now you come to story where it's super, super generic and vanilla. One story full of detail, full of character, names, places, and characteristics. And now Jesus comes to a place with all kinds of sick and all kinds of healing and towns and other generalities. What I think is super interesting about why this is so general is that I think Jesus has a word for all people at all times, not certain people at certain times. Sometimes when you come to a passage of Scripture where Jesus is doing something with somebody, you need to be so careful that you don't take a specific teaching or a specific word and then apply it to the masses. Well, what's true for you is true for everybody. That may not be true. When Jesus said to the rich young ruler, "You should go sell all of your possessions," he did not tell everybody to sell their possessions. So if you extrapolate a specific word to a specific person across all people, you get bad teaching. But here, there is no specificity. It's general. Read it again as you scan through there. It's all just broad strokes. Now, what you need to know about broad strokes is that it's like how we talk. Jesus went to all the places. Well, he didn't go to all the places. It's kind of like if you said to me, "So where did you go this week?" "Oh, I went to all kinds of places. I was everywhere." "Were you everywhere?" "Well, no, but you know, I'm getting around. I'm around the community." Jesus is not literally in all places. He was in a lot of places. When the author says he healed every sickness, we know that's not true. We know there are stories where Jesus does not heal everybody. Sometimes he walks into a crowd and heals one person. So it's not that Jesus actually went to all the places and healed every sick person. It's Jesus went to all kinds of places and healed all kinds of issues. Still tracking? Super general, super broad. And it says he looks at them, he has compassion on them. Now, again, I need you to preach with me tonight. Otherwise, I might just start getting cranky. Because here's what I believe to be true. I think maybe more than ever, the church is in jeopardy of losing their ability to be compassionate. Now, here's why I say that. You might think, "I don't know. I think the church is serving and loving and do." No, how do we as people care about anything when you know about everything? How do you care about anything deeply when you know about everything broadly? I am mortified to admit to you that I have heard about tragic stories in this community. I went, just another story. The world's a broken place. These things happen. Have you found yourself saying these things happen? Is it just me? Am I the only horrible person in this room? I've heard about horrible stories in this community, and I barely missed a beat. Now, I am tongue-in-cheek about what a horrible person I am. I'm just like a medium horrible person. The issue is, I don't know how to care about one thing deeply when I hear about everything all the time. I am having, and maybe you can nod with me or let me know if you're tracking, but I'm having a hard time distinguishing one child losing their life in Southwest Nova and all the tragedies of Afghanistan. I'm having a hard time knowing what is my burden to carry. I'm having a hard time knowing, am I actually on this earth to save every issue on God's green earth all the time? Do you feel that? How do we, in this culture and time, still carry the ability to be compassionate about something? Do not confuse reposting something on social media as compassion. Do not confuse liking, hearting, praying hands something on social media as being compassionate. there's a trick that happens in the brain that when you do that stuff, it makes it feel like you did something about the situation. I hope we never lose the ability to have compassionate, face-to-face, incarnate Jesus, flesh and blood, in a bleeding, hurting room where we just now post things on social media or leave a comment. I don't know about you, church. Maybe this is just confession for pastor time. It is so easy to type on a keyboard praying for you without actually praying for them. Is it just me? How do we have the heart of Jesus to look at a crowd with all these hurts and wounds and still keep our heart fleshy and squishy and not hard and stony? Somehow, Jesus looked out at a crowd. Let's pretend there's a crowd in this room tonight. Looked out at the crowd, and it said he sees them. Now, when I said last week that Zacchaeus and Jesus saw each other, I said to you there was a physical element and a spiritual element. We have, again, another spiritual element. Pretend Jesus is preaching to you tonight, which means two things. It would be remarkably better, and he would see you tonight. See, I see some of you, but Jesus would see some of you. And he would look at you and would know, hey, you look real sharp. I see you took a shower, threw some gel in your hair, put your nice jeans on, off you went to church. Put on your favorite ball cap, the Sunday ball cap. And off you go to church. And I'm looking, man, look at this good-looking bunch of people. Some of you even shaved this week. And Jesus would look at the room like, man, you have it all, but I see stuff. I see the hurts and the brokenness and the addictions. And Jesus would look at a room and see the layers of the room. I can't do that. How do we pray for God's heart, for the heart of Jesus, when we look at people, to have compassion over that one as if they were the only one? So since he looks at them, has compassion, and then he turns to the crowd and says, the harvest is plentiful and the workers are few. Now, again, I don't know how you read that, because sometimes when we look at the words of Jesus, it's not the words of Jesus I'm curious about, it's the tones of Jesus I'm curious about. Go home tonight in front of a mirror alone with nobody watching and read the phrase, the harvest is plentiful and the workers are few, and put the emphasis on different words with different tones and expressions. The harvest is plentiful and the workers are few. The harvest is plentiful and the workers are few. You can do this 100 times. I wonder what his tone was. My suspicion is that this was not a condescension moment. This was not a guilt and shame moment. I think this was a compare and contrast moment. I think he looked at the crowd and thought, man, the harvest is plentiful. There's an opportunity for the kingdom to advance in so many spaces, because I see so much hurt. I see so many wounds. I see so many opportunities where God could move and start. And he's looking across there. He's like, man, these people need what I have to offer them. There's so much harvest here today compared to the amount of people who are ready to bring in the harvest. Not shame and guilt, but scope and size. Meaning, the harvest will always outnumber the workers. Have you learned this to be true? There is no end to people in our community with hurts and needs. This cannot be new information for you. Is my mic on tonight? You're tracking still? Don't do this to me. There is so much hurt and brokenness. Like in this one day, I could rattle off half a dozen to a dozen stories that are tragic. There's all kinds of issues. We have somebody going through open heart surgery today. We have a mother who's worrying over her son who has cancer and found that out a few weeks ago. We have this story. We have this story of this kid in Glenwood. We have all kinds of things. We have marriage issues. You have financial issues. Any parents here find parenting really challenging and difficult? Any parents find it difficult to stay married to the person you're parenting with? Your vehicle issue, you have all these issues. We could go all day. The needs are plentiful, which means there's opportunities for God to move. There's never going to be an end to the needs. We're broken. We can say it together. We're a needy people. We've got things we need God to move. And what he's saying in this passage is there is not enough workers because I've seen the need, which means if any of you ever find me and say these words to me, you'll notice my skin going red. Oh, pastor, you don't need me. You've got all kinds of people around here. If you love me at all, even like 1%, if you care about me at all, never, ever speak of yourself in such diminishing terms that we don't need you because you've got enough people to help you around there. Number one, we don't exist to keep things moving around here. Number two, there's so much need and opportunity to serve and love that if every one of you text me tonight and said, I have 10 friends mobilized and ready, can you use us? I could put all of you to work. You're speaking in hyperbole. No, I'm not. You know your community, don't you? There's so much going on. Our mental health system is so backed up. There are people who just need an ear. Just someone to talk to, someone to listen. There's people, single parents going through stuff. There's parents trying to provide for their children, hardworking parents who cannot dig out of a hole. On and talk to Alex. There's teens and kids all through this community who need spiritual parents. I'm telling you, if all of you gave 100 hours a week, there's still need to go around. Jesus said, the poor you will always have with you. So there's this idea in this story where the needs far outnumber the workers. But I find the second thing super interesting that Jesus said workers. That's not real invitational, is it? Like, why didn't Jesus just say, the harvest is plentiful and the volunteers are few? The harvest is plentiful, but the church members, meh, a little thin. He doesn't even mention church attenders, which is what I care about most for my ego and my sanity. How many were at church tonight? Think of the choice of using the word workers. Why didn't you just say laborers? I need you to know something. Kingdom ministry is hard work. You will never hear me invite you to ministry by saying the words, all you have to do is, it'll only take a few moments of your time. Heavens no. If you want to serve in the kingdom, you will bleed deeply. If you want to serve people, they will hurt you and wound you. Do you know why? Because they're people. And if you start giving your life to serve people, if you start stepping into the gaps in our community, I promise you, you will get wounded, hurt, and you will leave some blood on the floor. How's that for a recruitment pitch? And guess what? It's all worth it. It is all worth it. I've never been hurt more in my life than from people inside the church. And I'll give my life to the church 10 lifetimes over. Can I do that in Christian faith? Can we do reincarnation? I'd do it all again. Because no matter how much blood has been shed, the blessings are worth it. To see somebody have the spiritual light bulb moment go off for the very first time, to hear somebody pray for the first time, to get a Facebook message from a dad, which I did during lockdown, that said, hey, pastor, guess what? I read my Bible. I hate that. I read my Bible to my kids for the first time. It is so worth it. Yes, people will hurt you and wound you. To see all the marriages fall apart at times breaks your heart. But then to see a marriage get redeemed, turned around, to watch baptisms at CR, it is worth it. You'll do it, you'll celebrate, and you'll have a few knife in your back along the way. Don't worry, they heal up over time. The last thing he says this whole idea that the need outweighs the number of people doing it. He says it is work. You are going to bleed through this. And then he says, pray to the God of the harvest to provide workers. Can I say this? I hate that so much. I hate that he says pray. I want him to say work. I want him to say tenacity and grit, and by the calluses of your hands, get it done. My flesh wants that. I want to dig in for Jesus. I want to work hard. But you know what's harder than working? Is being dependent. It is so much easier to work hard than to be dependent. And what he's saying there is pray to the God of the harvest to send workers. And so I look at the fall coming. I look at youth ministry launching and kids ministry and small groups. I look at South Church getting ready to launch and Coastal solidifying their roots in Barrington. I look at our church sending 30, 40, 50 people out and having to replenish new workers. And everything inside of me says, power up. Everything. Every ounce of my being says, white, knuckle this thing, put it on your back, drive this baby, and we'll reach more people. Everything inside of me. And Scripture says, nope. You're going to have to pray. But I want to work. He's like, nope, you're going to have to pray. Because guilting people into working doesn't work. Begging them doesn't work. Coercing them, persuading them, cashing in favors, I'll do anything, doesn't work. And what Jesus is calling us to tonight is this. Prayer. Will you pray this week? I don't want you to sign up for anything. There's no, like, when you go in the foyer, we're having a ministry fair. You can sign up for kids ministry and small groups. Nope. There's no opportunities to sign up for anything tonight. I want you to pray for a week. I want you to pray for a week and ask the Lord, what would you have me do? The pastor asked nothing of me. What would my Heavenly Father ask of me? And we're just going to pray. And we're going to pray to the God of the harvest. Say, Lord, this is your church. This is your ministry. This is your community. This is your region. So if you want me to do something, I'm not moving until you ask me. So we're going to pray, but first we're going to worship.
Desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, there is only one foundation. We believe, we believe. In this broken generation, when all is dark, you help us see. There is only one salvation. We believe, we believe. Christ, we believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again. We believe. Faith be more than anthems, greater than the songs we sing. Oh, in our weakness and temptations, we believe, we believe in God the Father. Jesus Christ, we believe.
and he's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that he conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and he's coming back again. We believe.
Join me in prayer. God, we're not quite down with that song, but there's that opening phrase, in this broken generation. And I feel like the author of that song had something similar that Matthew had in mind. He's not speaking of a specific generation. There's brokenness in all generations. And God, in this broken generation, God, it's time for the church to double down on what we believe to be true. It's time to reaffirm what our foundation is, who we are hoping in, and what our eternal reward is. And so God, tonight I just wanna pray. I wanna send people out in a praying spirit, Lord. That God, it is so, everything inside of me wants to mobilize for action tonight, but your word is calling us to be dependent on you to provide. And so God, we submit ourselves today. God, I give you this church and I take my hands off it tonight. God, if there are going to be new workers, you're going to have to call them. You're going to have to nudge their heart. God, you're going to have to do what you do best, because we will not guilt people into this. We don't want to trick people into serving. We don't want to minimize the cost of what it requires to actually see life and eternal changes. But God, I want to pray for a second group tonight. Not the new workers that you might call, but the renewed workers. God, I feel like you are looking on this room like Jesus looked upon that crowd, and you see helpless and harassed people. That God, this has been a hellish 18 months, emotionally, mentally, spiritually, and physically for people. And God, then a pastor gets up and says, hey, let's charge a new mountain. And your people are exhausted. And so God, what I'm praying tonight is that this exhausted people in an exhausted community would not power up, would not white knuckle it, but would find a new dependence and source of energy that comes from your Holy Spirit. God, there is this weird thing in your kingdom where all the metrics can say we don't have enough, we don't have what it takes. But by the anointing of your Holy Spirit, by providing more of you and less of us, we find this second wind, this energy and this strength that makes no earthly sense, make no human sense, where you provide and you bless for your people, for the work that you have called us to. And so God, may we find that not by revving up, but by resting in you. So Jesus, I pray for those who are fatigued. I pray for those who've been serving on the front lines for so long. God, I pray for the responders. I pray for our government. I pray for our medical people. I pray for the stay-at-home moms who've been serving their families day in and day out. I pray for our fishermen. I pray for our construction workers. God, I know I've missed 100 jobs and careers. Would you pour out your spirit fresh and new today? Would you renew them in your strength for your work? And so God, we're gonna worship, we're gonna sing, and we're gonna wait this week to see what you would say to us. And we declare this in your name, amen. Would you stand in closing?
The lost be found and the dead be raised in the here and now. Love in vain, let the church live aloud. Our God will say, we believe. Let the lost, let the lost be found, and the dead be raised in the here and now. The loving maid, let the church live aloud. Our God will say, we believe. It's our prayer. Let the lost be found, and the dead be raised in the here and now. The loving maid, let the church live aloud. Our God will say, we believe. One more time, let the lost be found in the dead.
God will say, we believe in the gates of hell. In the gates of hell will not prevail. For the power of God is torn the veil. Now we know your love will never fail. We believe, we believe, we believe in God the Father. Oh, we believe in Jesus Christ. Coming back again, we believe. Oh, we believe.
We need to be reminded of this truth, especially in this season, to give us focus. We're taking Jesus into every community of Southwest Nova. But I love that AJ reminds us that that has to start with prayer. It cannot start with white knuckling it. And so as you go, as you seek after Jesus, as you seek after the Father's heart, the benediction today is remembering that as you walk out of this building and those front doors, look up. And you're going to see a statement that says, taking Jesus into every community of Southwest Nova. And what I want you to do is, as you leave this place seeking the Father's heart, I want you to ask yourself throughout this next week, how can I play a part in that? How has God wired me for that? I believe God is up to stuff. I believe it's in his heart, as AJ already preached, it's in his heart to move, to do things. And he wants to use us. We'll see you next week's church.